Okay, so today I'm gonna show you all my favorite features, tools, effects, tips and tricks in DaVinci Resolve 20 to help you get a cinematic film look. And just so you know, this is not a color grading tutorial, it's more like a list of cherries that you can put on top of your color grades. And some tips and tricks to get better results faster. And some things are available in the free version of DaVinci Resolve, some only in the studio version. Okay, here we go. First of all, don't forget the basics. Because, like, no matter how many cherries you put on top of your color grade, if your color correction, for example, is bad, an effect is not gonna save it. Won't happen. So learn how to properly color correct your image first. Learn the color wheels, the curves. And look, you don't have to become an expert. I'm not an expert. But definitely learn the basics. How to get neutral whites, how to get the skin tones right. You know, just the basic stuff so that you can start color grading with a decent base. And even if you're using the free version of DaVinci Resolve, you can get the most beautiful film looks imaginable. No problem, if you know what you're doing. So learn the basics. Next is Color Slice, and it's quickly becoming one of my favorite tools. Now, at first glance, it might seem like it's not a tool that you can use to get a cinematic film look, but it's actually designed for exactly that. This is how Blackmagic Design describes it. Now, what does that mean? What does it do? Well, if you watch a lot of old movies, or new movies also, shot on film, you might have noticed that the colors of film always look super dense and rich, without looking overly saturated. And maybe you've tried to achieve that same look, those colors, by cranking up the saturation. But of course that won't work. It will just look overly saturated. Unless you use the Color Slice tool, because it allows you to adjust color density and saturation without making it look overly saturated. So it's specifically designed to get those deep, rich, dense colors of film. Definitely a tool you should learn how to use. This is one of my all-time favorite effects. This is what, in my opinion, a film look needs: halation. You can find it in the Effects tab in the color page. And what is halation exactly? Well, it's the effect where a soft, usually reddish-orangey glow appears around bright areas of an image, usually also high contrast areas. And when shooting on actual film, it's caused by light reflecting off the film emulsion and bouncing back into the lens. And because red light is more sensitive to reflection, you get that warm glow. But of course, when you apply it in post with the halation effect, for example, you can make it look however you want. Super subtle or heavy and over the top. I usually like it somewhere in between. Glow is similar to halation, but it's available in the free version of DaVinci Resolve. Also in the effects library in the color page. And this effect creates a glow around bright areas. Light sources, for example. See? If I lower the shine threshold, you can see it better. But there are tons of settings that you can play around with. And for example, what I sometimes do is set the composite mode to soft light. And then, let me lower the shine threshold. See? You get a glowy effect, but the colors and the overall image also looks richer and denser. You instantly get more of a film look, so try it out. And something else that's also available in the free version of DaVinci Resolve is the built-in film look LUTs. You can find them here, in the color page, and then LUTs, and then film look LUTs. And these are actual film stock emulations. So they make your image look like what that actual film stock looks like. Now, I've already done a few tutorials on how to use these LUTs. I'll link them in the description. But what you have to do basically is add a color space transform and set the output gamma to Cineon Film Log. And then after that color space transform, you add the film look LUTs. Because these LUTs need Cineon Film Log as the input gamma. If you don't convert to Cineon Film Log first, see, then it doesn't look right. The contrast, it's all off. And you're probably gonna wanna use these here, the Rec. 709 LUTs. If you wanna get a cool film look fast in the free version of DaVinci Resolve, try the film look LUTs. And this is just a practical tip. So you have a lot of tools to help you, right? The scopes, false color. But the two most important ones, in my opinion, are the vector scope and the waveform. But the thing is, you have to learn how to read them, right? For example, a lot of beginners don't know that the waveform, for example, is basically showing you the image from left to right. This peak here, for example, is my lightning neon sign. And when I move the playhead, for example, when I wave my hand, see, you can literally see me waving my hand in the waveform. So learn how to read the scopes, because they give you objective information. They take all of the guessing out of your color grading process. But not all the cherries that I put on top of my color grades are available in DaVinci Resolve. I also use a lot of stuff from MotionVFX, the sponsor of this video. They offer a ton of effects, plugins, transitions, and titles to help you get a cinematic film look. From super subtle to super dramatic. Effects like M-Style 8mm, for if you want to get that instant retro look, but also cinematic titles and transitions, like the new M-Transition Whipcut Pack. There's so much to discover on their website, you won't know where to look first. But if I may suggest something, maybe start with the Oldie but Goldie challenge for a chance to win some money and some really cool prizes. Just download the free Oldie but Goldie collection and then transform some of your old footage into a cool 60-second retro edit. And if you need some inspiration, I did something similar a few years ago. Also with plugins from MotionVFX, by the way. I'll also link that one in the description. These are effects that you should use sporadically. Lens flares, light rays, and lens reflections. Old movies often have lens flares and reflections. The image is never super clean and sterile, you know what I mean? But like I said, use them sporadically, because even though it's possible to get super cool and realistic results, it's not easy to get there, but it is easy to overdo it. But anyway, a cool little anamorphic flare or lens reflection, also available in the effects library, by the way, if done right, looks amazing. But this is really like a cherry on top, you know? Just to add a little bit of extra atmosphere and character to some of your shots. Don't use them on all your shots. Okay, super simple. Film never looks super sharp. Or, I mean, it looks sharp, but it also doesn't. You know what I mean? And digital often looks digitally sharp, a bit too sharp. So if you shoot digital, a quick way to get rid of that digital look is by just blurring your image. Not too much, of course, just enough to get rid of that digital edge. Now, there are different ways to do it. You can use the blur tab here in the color page, but I usually like the result of the Gaussian blur a little bit better. So just try out some different options to see what you like best. And then, kind of on the same level as blur, is film grain. Why? Because, I mean, the name says it, film grain. And film grain is caused by small, randomly distributed silver halide crystals. And the higher the ISO of the film, the bigger the crystals are. Because bigger crystals are more sensitive to light. So there you go, that's where it comes from. And you can also find it in the effects library. And there's a bunch of presets to choose from and a bunch of settings and parameters to adjust. But the difficult thing about film grain is, well, YouTube or Instagram, or uploading to YouTube or Instagram. Because uploading to one of those platforms means compression. And compression sometimes destroys film grain, or it might create unwanted artifacts. So depending on the resolution of your video, the size in which your video will be viewed mostly, well, you have to play around with the settings a bit to get the perfect film grain for your video and to make sure that it's still there after the upload, after the compression. So I can't give you settings that will always work. You have to try it out yourself. Okay, this is just a simple one-click adjustment, but it's an important one, and it makes a huge difference sometimes. It's this one, tone mapping in your color space transform node. The last one that transforms your image to Rec. 709. And what tone mapping does is basically, yeah, it compresses the dynamic range of a scene to the available dynamic range of the color space or display so that nothing's clipping. And you usually see it most in very bright and colorful areas. It's set to DaVinci by default, which is a good setting most of the time. But see what happens when I turn it off? The lighting sign and even my skin, it's all clipping. So when I turn it on, it compresses all those clipped areas to fit within the Rec. 709 color space. So the tone mapping pulls them back in. But anyway, the standard setting is DaVinci, which is usually fine, but sometimes, especially when there are very bright and colorful light sources, like my neon sign, I find that the luminance mapping setting gives me a better result, a more pleasing result, especially when I want to get those rich, dense colors of film. You see the difference here? Luminance mapping, DaVinci. So definitely try it out when there's lots of bright colors, luminance mapping. And then finally, make sure that whenever you're using multiple effects, that you put them in the correct order. For example, film grain and blur. If you put a blur node after the film grain node, the blur effect is also gonna blur your film grain. And of course you don't want that. So it's always better to put film grain after the blur effect. So always think about the order of your nodes when using multiple effects. And that's it for today. So go try it out, go do some color grading, add some cherries on top. Thank you so much for watching and see you in the next one.